In this video, we'll be looking at chi-square tests and dihybrid crosses. I already made a video on chi-square tests and monohybrid crosses, and it's really important for you to understand how to do a monohybrid cross before you learn how to do a dihybrid cross. So if you haven't checked out that video yet, I'll put a link to it in the description of this video. And if you find this video really helpful and you would like to have more practice doing chi-square tests, monohybrid crosses, and dihybrid crosses, let me know in the comments and I'll make another video that goes over some more practice problems. A chi-square test is a statistical test used to see if observed values for a set of data are similar to or significantly different from expected values. Statistical tests like chi-square tests are extremely important because rarely do our observations match perfectly with our expectations. Statistical tests like the chi-square test allow us to determine if our observed values are significantly different from our expected values. Gregor Mendel was a famous biologist that used chi-square tests to demonstrate that he could predict the phenotypic ratio of offspring whenever he was performing crosses among pea plants. In this video, you're going to learn how to use a chi-square test to determine if your observations are significantly different from what you would have expected to see when you perform a certain cross between pea plants of specific genotypes. Specifically, we're going to be looking at a dihybrid cross here. And a dihybrid cross is a cross involving two separate traits. And the traits that we're going to look at as an example here will be pod color and plant height. So these are two different traits and they are caused by two different genes. So a separate gene controls pod color and plant height. And there also can be different variations of a gene. Usually what we have is what we call a dominant allele and a recessive allele. So these are the different variations of a gene that can occur. So for example, for the gene that causes or controls pod color, we can have the dominant allele or dominant variation of that gene. And we're going to represent that by capital G, and that's going to cause green pods. And then we also could have a recessive allele, and that will cause yellow pods. With plant height, the two different alleles that are possible is the dominant allele represented by capital T, which would cause the plant to be tall. And then the recessive allele causes the short stature. Now, there are a lot of different possible phenotypes that could occur when you look at the combination of these two traits. You can have plants that have green pods and are tall. They can have green pods and be short. They can have yellow pods and be tall. Or they can have yellow pods and be short. Now, there are several different possible genotypes that can cause each phenotype. So remember, each individual has for each gene, they have to have two alleles for that gene, okay? One that they inherited from each parent, okay? So in order to have green pods and be tall, they had to have inherited at least one dominant allele from one of the parents in order for them to express that trait. So there are actually four possible genotypes that could lead to a plant being green and tall, okay? So they could have two dominant alleles for the pod color gene and two dominant alleles for the plant height gene. So then they would be tall. They could be big G, little g, big T. That would be green and tall. They could also be a big G, little g, big T. So they're heterozygous for both genes and that would still make them green and tall. And then the other possibility is to be big G, big T. So there's actually four different genotypes that would lead to a plant being green and tall. So that's something to remember. Now to have green pods and be short, can you think of the possible genotypes that could result in those traits? Well, there's actually two, okay? So in order to be short, in order to express the recessive allele, you have to have two copies of it. So the only way a plant could be short is if it has two recessive alleles, so little t. And in order for it to be expressing the dominant allele for the pod color, it has to have at least one big G. So it could be big G, or it could be big G. Now, in order for it to have yellow pods and be tall, what are the possible genotypes there? Well, that would be little g, big T, or little g, big T. So again, in order for them to express the recessive trait for the pod color, they have to have two recessive alleles, so two little g's. Okay, and then for them to have yellow pods and be short, they would have to be homozygous recessive for both of the genes. So be little g, little t. So there's only one genotype that could result in the plant expressing both recessive traits. Okay, so now with that background information, let's look at a little bit more practice with dihybrid crosses to make sure you understand this concept. So let's say that we have a green plant that is tall and it's homozygous dominant for both of the genes. So big G, big G, big T, big T. And then that's being crossed with a plant that is yellow and short. So it has to be homozygous recessive for each of those genes. Little g, little t, little t. Okay, so what type of gametes? Okay, so in other words, what type of sperm or egg could these plants produce? Okay, so whenever a individual is producing gametes, these are the sex cells, they can only give one allele for each of those genes. Okay, so they're going to only be able to give one allele for the pod color gene. And in this case, they can only give a big G because that's all they got, right? They can only give one allele for their pair of alleles for the other gene. So that would be a big T. So that's what would be present in the gametes. In this individual, again, they can only give a little g and a little t to their offspring. Whenever these two gametes fertilize each other, that means they fuse with each other to create a new individual, what would the genotype of that new individual be? Well, they'll be heterozygous for both genes. Big G, big T, little t. What would the phenotype, or in other words, the physical appearance be for the individuals in that generation? Well, all of them would have to be green and tall because of their genotype. So let's say that two pea plants that are heterozygous for both of the gene for pod color and plant height are crossed. This means that each of those pea plants has the genotype big G, little t. The number of offspring of each phenotype is counted. So after we cross those individuals, we actually count the number of the different phenotypes or physical characteristics of each of the offspring. Okay, and that is shown here on the table on the right. So we have 790 that we observe that are green and tall, 257 are green and short, 280 are yellow and tall, and 113 are yellow and short. That makes a total of 1,440 offspring. So the question we're going to ask is, do the observed values that we saw here differ significantly from what would be expected based on Mendelian genetics? So in order to see if the observed values differ significantly from the expected values, we first have to calculate what the expected values would be. Okay, so here I created a table that allows you to calculate this chi-square value. And here you see the column with our categories here on the left. Those are our phenotypes. Here are our observed values. So this is what we actually counted among the offspring. And then in the next column, we have to calculate how many of each phenotype we would have expected to see based on a cross between these two genotypes. In order to figure out the expected number of offspring of each phenotype, we would have to perform a Punnett square. A Punnett square is a square diagram that allows you to determine the probability that a certain phenotype will occur in the offspring. So in other words, it tells us what we would expect to see. So there's actually two different ways to perform Punnett squares when solving dihybrid crosses, and you get the same answer both ways. The first method is known as the FOIL method, and the second method involves performing a separate Punnett square for each trait. So you would perform a Punnett square for pod color, and then you perform a Punnett square for plant height, and then you could actually determine the probability of having both traits by just doing some simple math, which I'll show you later. I recommend learning how to do it both ways. One of the benefits of understanding how to do this both ways is that you can check your answer. So you should get the same answer using both strategies, and that can tell you whether you made some simple error along the way. Also, you never know what method your professor might prefer you to use, so it's always good to know both of these strategies. So let's look at how we can use each one. Okay, so here you can see the genotype of each parent. Remember, each parent is heterozygous for both of the traits that we're looking at. So remember, on the top of the Punnett square, you're going to write the possible gametes that one of the parents can make. Okay, so using the FOIL method, FOIL stands for first, outer, inner, and last, I believe. So what you're going to do is look at all the possible combinations of G's and T's that you can make from each parent. So we're looking at this parent here. We would take the first letter from each pair, and we would get big G, big T. Then we would take the outer letters and get big G, little t. Then we would take the inner letters here. Little g can be paired with big T, and then little g can be paired with little t. Do you do the same thing for the other parent? Big G would be paired with big T, and then big G can be paired with little t. Or little g could be paired with big T, and little g could be paired with little t. And that gives you all the possible gametes that could be created from each parent. So next, what we do in order to figure out the genotypes of the offspring, we just combine these letters together. Okay, so I take these letters here and combine them with these letters here. So I would get big G, big G, big T, big T. Do the same thing for the next one. You get big G, big G, big T, little t. Do the next ones. Big G, little g, big T, big T. Big G, big T, little t. Next row again, big G, big G, big T, little t. So I'm just bringing these letters and these letters together into each square. I recommend always writing the capital letter first when you're writing up each pair. So notice here that I put the big T first and then the little t next. And that's something I always do just to maintain consistency. Hopefully you're seeing that pattern, and I'll fill out the rest of the Punnett square for you. Okay, so that's how you fill out the Punnett square, and you can see all the possible genotypes combinations that can happen in the offspring. Now let's look at how we can set up these Punnett squares if we're going to look at each trait individually. This strategy, once you understand it, is actually a lot quicker to do, and there's less chance of errors when you do it this way. At least I believe that. So we're going to separate out pod color and plant height. Okay, so for pod color, that's controlled by the G gene in our example here. So this parent is big G, little g, and this parent is big G, little g as well. So we separate that out. And then we just create a Punnett square for that one trait. So for this individual here, this parent, they can contribute a big G or little g to the offspring. This parent can give a big G or a little g to the offspring. Bring those letters together to figure out the possible offspring. We get big G, big G, big G, little g, big G, little g, and little g, little g. Now for the other trait, plant height, similar thing. Each parent is heterozygous for that gene, so the possible gametes this parent can create would be big T, little t. This other parent would be big T or little t as well. Bring those alleles together and you get big T, big T, big T, little t, big T, little t, and little t, little t. All right, so now how do we determine the probability of having each phenotype in the offspring by using these Punnett squares? So what I did here was I gave a different color code to each phenotype. And I'm going to show you which phenotype each square represents based on the genotype. So remember, to have green pods and be tall, you have to have at least one dominant allele. So going through here, the first square, that individual will be green and tall. Then the next one, green and tall. Green and tall, green and tall. Green and tall. This one would be green and short because they have two recessive alleles. So the only way that you could express the recessive trait is to have two recessive alleles. So that would be green and short. This one would be green and tall. This one would be green and short. This one would be green and tall. Green and tall. This one would be yellow and tall because it has two recessive alleles for that first gene. This one would also be yellow and tall. This one would be green and tall. This one would be green and short. And this one would be yellow and tall. And then this one would be yellow and short. Okay, so what's the probability? Well, that's really easy to calculate once you've figured out what phenotype each one of these squares would represent. So there are 16 squares total. How many are green and tall? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So that's 9 out of 16. Or you could present that as a percentage. That would be 56.25%. So if you did 9 divided by 16, that would give you 0.5625. Multiply that by 100, that gives you the percent. Green pods and short, there's 3 out of 16, or 18.75%. Yellow pods and tall, there's 3 out of 16, that's 18.75% again. And then yellow pods and short, that's only 1 out of 16, or 6.25%. Sometimes your professor likes you to represent this as a phenotypic ratio. So you could represent that as 9 to 3 to 3 to 1. 9 to 3 to 3 to 1 would be the phenotypic ratio of offspring. Now let's see how we could calculate the probabilities using these two separate Punnett squares in method 2 on the right here. So here in the first Punnett square, you would look at how many of these offspring would have green pods. So that would be 1, 2, 3. How many would have yellow pods? That would just be 1. So the probability of them having green pods would be 3/4. Yellow pods would be 1 out of 4. For plant height, how many are tall? We have 1, 2, 3 out of the 4 that are tall. For short, we have 1 of them that would be short, right? So the probability that they would be tall would be 3/4. Probability they'd be short would be 1/4. So how can we calculate the probability the offspring will have both traits? We just multiply the probabilities of each having each trait. What's the probability that they will have green pods and be tall? You would just take 3/4 times 3/4. So 3/4 times 3/4, when you're multiplying fractions, you just multiply the numerator and then multiply the denominator. So 3 times 3 equals 9, 4 times 4 is 16, so that gives us 9/16, or 56.25%. That's the same thing we saw over here on the left side. Green pods and short, so you take 3/4 times 1/4, 3 times 1 is 3, 4 times 4 is 16, so that gives us 3/16, same thing you got over on the left. For yellow pods and tall, that'd be 1/4 times 3/4. 1 times 3 is 3. 4 times 4 is 16. That gives you the same thing we got before. And then yellow pods and short, that would just be 1/4 times 1/4. 1 times 1 is 1. 4 times 4 is 16. That gives you 6.25%. So you see, you can solve this either way. You'll get the exact same answers. So now let's look at how we can determine the expected values based on these probabilities that we got from doing the Punnett squares. All you gotta do to get the expected number of offspring is you take the probability and you multiply it by the total number of offsprings there are. So what is 9/16 times 1,440? That equals 810. So there would be 800, you would expect to see 810 green and tall offspring. 3/16 of them would be expected to be green and short. So you take 3/16 times 1,440, that equals 270. For them to be yellow and tall, you would take 3/16 times 1440 again, that would equal 270. And for them to be yellow and have yellow pods and be short, that would be 1/16 of 1,440, and that would equal 90. And there you go. You've got your observed values and your expected values. And then the rest of this is pretty straightforward. You might have been presented with an equation for solving the chi-square value, but that equation is being represented by this table here. This equation pretty much says that the chi-square value equals the sum of each observation minus what was expected for that observation. Square that and then divide it by that expected value. And notice we're doing each of those steps here. And then in the last column, we're just going to add them all up. Okay, so next step we have to do is take each observed value and subtract it by the expected value. So for green and tall, that would be 790 minus 810. That would give you negative 20. For the next column, for green and short, it would be 257 minus 270. That would give you negative 13. Then for 280 minus 270, that would give you 10. And then our last row would be 113 minus 90, which would give us 23. Okay, so then the next step is to just square that value. So negative 20 squared is 400. Negative 13 squared is 169. 10 squared is 100. 23 squared is 529. And you just put them in those columns. And then the last step is to take this value and divide it by the expected value that we had calculated. Okay, so we would take 400 and divide it by 810. That equals 0.494. Then we would take 169 divided by 270. That was our expected value. And that would be 0.626. And then we take 100 divided that by 270. That would give us 0.370. And then finally, 529 divided by 90. And that would equal 5.878. So in order to calculate the chi-square value, remember that based on the equation, we just sum up all of these values that we calculated. So you just sum up this last column here. We take 0.494 plus 0.626 plus 0.37 plus 5.878, and we get 7.368, and that is our chi-square value. So we're going to need to use this chi-square value to find the p-value in a table. The p-value is really important in statistical tests because this is a number between 0 and 1. And if the p-value is less than 0.05, okay, so if it's a very small number, then that tells you that there is a statistical significant difference between the observed and expected values that you saw. Okay, however, if the p-value is larger than 0.05, then that tells you there's no difference. There's no statistical difference between the observed and expected values. So although the observed and expected values may be different, that's probably just due to random variation. Okay, however, if the p-value is really small, then that tells you that something more complex is probably going on and that those two values are too different from each other for you to be able to claim that they are similar. In order to figure out the p-value, you have to use a chi-square table. You can find a table like this by searching online, and you can simply search for a chi-square table for goodness of fit. There are several different chi-square tests. When you're doing a test like this to look at observed versus expected values when you're doing genetics, we're going to be using a goodness of fit test. Okay, so you're going to find this table. All these tables should have similar values on them. And when you're looking at this table, the top row is telling you the p-values. Okay, so those are the p-values up there. Within the table, all these other numbers in here, these are the chi-square values. And then on the left column, what you're seeing is the degrees of freedom. Okay, the degrees of freedom equal the number of categories minus one. So in this case, we have four different categories. So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4 categories. 4 minus 1 equals 3. So our degrees of freedom is 3 in this case. Okay, and that's going to be really important because you need to know the degrees of freedom to know which row to look at on this table. Okay, so we know the degrees of freedom are 3. So next, what we're going to do is search for our chi-square value on that third row. And our chi-square value is 7.368. So that falls between 6.25 and 7.82. So we look up here in the top and that tells you the range where our p-value would fall. Okay, and so we know based on this table that our p-value falls between 0.05 and 0.1. Okay, so what is our conclusion? Our conclusion is that our p-value is greater than 0.05 and less than 0.1. And since our p-value is greater than 0.05, we can conclude that there is no significant difference between the observed and expected values in our experiment here. So now let's walk through a summary of the steps that we performed. These are going to be the same when you're doing a monohybrid cross versus a dihybrid cross. So the first thing that we did was we recorded the observed values. Then we found the expected values using a Punnett square and also using the total number of offspring. Remember, we used the Punnett square to figure out the probability of each phenotype of offspring. And then we took that probability, we multiplied it by the total number of offspring. That gave us the expected value that we would expect to see for each different phenotype. Then we calculated the chi-square value. After we got the chi-square value, we used a chi-square table and we looked at the row with the correct degrees of freedom. In that row, we found where our chi-square value that we calculated falls. And then we looked at the top of that row to find the range where our p-value falls. Then we used that p-value to make a conclusion of whether our observed values were significantly different from our expected values or not. I also recommend that after you perform one of these tests and you do it all by hand, that you check your answers. There are many online chi-square calculators that you can use. And here is a link, I'll put that in the description as well, to a chi-square online calculator that you can use to test your answers. Just because this chi-square calculator can give you the answers doesn't mean, though, that it isn't important to understand how you got those answers. So whenever you're doing a biology lab or something like that, you still need to be able to show all your work of how you actually got those answers. But you can always double check your answers to make sure you didn't make some careless errors. So let me click on this to show you what these calculators may look like. So here I could just show you how you can easily calculate the p-value using a chi-square calculator. So here's the chi-square value that we calculated, and our degrees of freedom was 3. We're using the significance level of 0.05, meaning that's the cutoff, right, where the p-value tells you whether it's significant or not significant. And then all you do is push calculate, and it says our p-value is 0.061. So the result is not significant at a p-value of less than 0.05, and that is exactly what we concluded. So here it says our p-value is 0.061, so that's giving you the actual p-value. Remember that we couldn't calculate the actual p-value using this table. So again, the online calculator calculated our p-value is 0.061. And you can see 0.061 for our p-value does fall between 0.05 and 0.1, which is exactly what we determined using this chi-square table. And let's just say that you wanted to actually calculate your chi-square value using the calculator, you can do that as well. If you scroll down here, it says chi-square calculator for goodness of fit. You would fill out this table and let me do that real quickly for you. So I'm just going to put these values right here from our table that we determined. So the phenotype, the observed values, and expected values, I put that in here on this online calculator. My significance level is 0.05 because, again, that's the cutoff we're going to be using. And then we click calculate chi-square. And look, they actually filled everything out for us here like we just did on our table. And the chi-square value they calculated is 7.368. Does that match ours? Yes, it does. So again, there's a lot of ways you can double check your answers, but don't take shortcuts. Use that just as a way to check that whether you made any simple errors. And I hope that this video helped you understand how to use chi-square tests doing dihybrid crosses. If you would like more practice doing this, please comment in this video and let me know. I can actually put up another video where you can practice doing a chi-square test using a monohybrid and dihybrid cross. And it's one that is typically used in biology labs. Also, if you really like this video, please do not forget to like it and share it with somebody else who might find it helpful.